Guys talk about their cars.
Gosh, he needs to even run a gas pedal.
Still has a moment of Yeah. impact or whatever.
Well, it's a pretty fascinating project, and I think that one of the yeah, they took me through, I mean, to the inside, went down into the basement, and to the basement, and was the
should be...
Which one's forward?
Let's just see. I think it's just basically... Oh, here. Yeah, so we should be able... We can just... Yeah, actually, I'll just make sure that...
Thank you.
Okay, alors bonsoir tout le monde. Welcome everyone to our Urbanism Lab event for this evening. Je m'appelle Heather Thompson, je suis gestionnaire en patrimoine avec la CCN. My name is Heather Thompson, I'm the manager of the Heritage Program here at the NCC. Juste quelques mots de housekeeping, disons. En cas d'urgence, vous avez les portes des deux côtés ici pour l'urgence. Les toilettes sont à la sortie à la droite. Et, so in case of emergency, please use the doors on either side, and the washrooms are on your right. On your way out. So that's a quick, housekeeping. Thank you very much. We're very pleased to have everyone here this evening, and it's been a very good turnout. We were sold out in a few days' time once we posted the event on the website. So there's great interest in this topic. I guess in order to start, I'd like to introduce Sherilyn Sarazin from the Band Council of Pickwocknagon to come and open our event. Thank you very much.
Kwe, Mino Kinjabon. Waba Washwish Keshi Kwe, Wabashishi Nidodum Pikwaknagon Nadanjaba. Pajashik Dimengizi. Kwe Mishomas, Kwe Mkokomas, Kwe Kichimanadu. Kachimi Gwich Kichimanadu, Minwa Nagoding. Giwabdungam, Kishib Kizis, Gibanabad. Kachimi Gwich, Gimi Zhang, Ilsa Bamatawin. Kachimi Gwich, Gimi Zhang, Nigigog. Wadokwishnang Jidamayang, Gwayak Jamoseyang, Kachimigwech, Kachimanado, Kinegego, Magwech. Sorry, something happened to my notes, my digital notes. I'd like to start off by saying, my name is Sherilyn Sarazin. I'm a Nagonzikwe, a counselor for the Algonquins of Pickwocknagon First Nation. And on behalf of my chief and council, I'd like to welcome you to unceded Algonquin traditional territory. In the spirit of reconciliation, I'd like to take this opportunity to tell you more about the Algonquin and Anishinaabeg in our territory. We've occupied the territory of the Kichisibi, which is the Great River, and the Mattawang, now known as the Mattawa River, where the river divides is what it means in Algonquin. Watersheds for over 10,500 years since the last ice age. We and then other indigenous nations have had our own territories, governance, spirituality, and vast networks of trade, exchanges of goods and information, an abundance of natural resources, health, and happiness. 500 years ago, when Europeans arrived, the indigenous populations of Turtle Island was in the millions. Europeans brought with them disease to which the indigenous had no immunity, their governance based on expansion and exploitation, and their programs of indigenous cultural genocide. These impositions have had devastating effects on us. We had a resource-based economy. We lived by hunting, fishing, and gathering. Our socio-economic organization was characterized by seasonal migration within a defined geographic area. We were organized into small family-based groups and that utilized resources cooperatively. Typically, interrelated groups congregated annually, usually in the summer, at resource-rich base locations for social, religious, and political and economic activities. I'd like to elaborate more on whose traditional territory the city of Ottawa was built. The early explorations of Samuel de Champlain in his journals in various meetings with the Algonquins from 1603 to 1613. Just as the word was inaccurately labeled upon us, it was he who began calling us Algonquin. It is now not how we referred to ourselves. We referred to ourselves as the Omamawini, which means the people down the river. At the time of Day and Trigger in the 17th century, the Ononchatoronon, the people of the geese, or the people of Iroquet, occupied South Nation River as their territory until their displacement in 1615. The period between 1640 to the end of the 17th century was a period of extensive warfare between the Iroquois and the Hurons, Algonquins and their allies. There was also widespread epidemics during large numbers of people died. Watersheds were raided repeatedly and extensively by the Iroquois until Huronia was destroyed in 1648. In 1650, during this time, the Algonquins and Nipissings and Hurons fled from the Iroquois and found refuge in various locations, but we did not completely abandon the Ottawa Valley. They headed to the headwaters of the tributaries to seek refuge until the end of the century. By the 17th century, the Iroquois had been driven out, and during the period of 1716, the Algonquins were known to be living at the Gatineau River. Constant Pinency of the Partridge Band was the son of Chief Wamblock. His full name was Pierre Louis Constant Pinency. Pinency means partridge in Algonquin. He married Marguerite Nipawikwe by the Sulpicians in Oka at the Lake of Two Mountains near Montreal. They had seven children. The hunting territory was centered at the confluence of the Rideau and Ottawa Rivers. The Partridge Band spent summer at the Lake of Two Mountains. This is supported by census records. The band consisted of 64 families, equaling 253 individuals. He fought in the War of 1812, and by 1830, he was the Grand Chief of the Algonquins. He was known to have lived several years on the Madawaska River. Earliest detailed petitions from the Algonquins in 1772 clearly consistently describe the territory as encompassing both sides of the Ottawa River. They were actively using the area for hunting and trapping. These petitions were repeated in 1791 to 1792 when the Constitutional Act divided up Lower and Upper Canada. Also, at the same time, Townships B, Gloucester Township, and Townships D, Nepean Township, were created. In 1800, Philemon Wright began logging the Ottawa Valley for the Royal Navy. Chief Pinency had a second wife, Marie Joseph Penisique. They both died in August 13th, 1834, during a cholera epidemic. They were buried the following day. The Mission Cemetery is where their bones lie, which is no longer visible because it's been paved over. From 1800s to present is more accurately recorded in present-day history books. This timeline of events is evident that the Algonquins and Anishinaabeg lived in a specific area during certain times of the year, which was usually when the food was plentiful, and then moved to another area for the wintering months where food and resources would provide them for them during the harsh winter months. By living in this cycle, it allowed Mother Nature to replenish and heal herself. It was also a common practice to never take more than you need. This practice was also the invention of conservation and sustainability. We recognize the interconnectedness of all things animate and inanimate, the sacred responsibility and the quality of relationships within that interconnectedness. And my favorite quote would be from Peter Hessel in his book, The Algonquin Nation. It goes like this: "The land shaped the Algonquins. They were a product of the forest, as were the animals and the plants that lived within it and on whom their livelihood depended. We had a deep, meaningful relationship with all living things and a rich and spiritual life." With that, I'd like to close with Anishinaabeg Bemadzuwin Buxin Don Miigwech.
I would like to thank Sherry Lynn for your words. Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much for doing our opening, and I have this gift for you on behalf of the NCC.
Oh, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, members of the board of the NCC who are here, and I know we have people from many interested organizations and possibly outside. Is there anybody here from outside the capital? Yeah, there are some people. Yeah, no, I had heard some people had come for this, which I was very pleased. So, good evening. Bonsoir. Kwe kakina. Bienvenue à tous ainsi qu'aux gens qui nous regardent en direct sur YouTube. We broadcast these through YouTube and we have a growing following. So hello everyone who's watching online. I know, I think there's some people here from Carleton. Is that true? Yeah, that we've got some from Carleton. Is there anyone here from the city of Ottawa or Gatineau? Yes, some people here from that. That's good. I know somebody was coming from Willowbank, from the school. Thank you for coming in bad weather. We appreciate you here. So my name is Mark Christmanson. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of the National Capital Commission. Et le sujet dont nous parlerons ce soir est au centre du travail de la CCN. As a steward, the NCC has long worked to preserve the built heritage of the capital, which contributes significantly to its unique character. And as a planner, one of our top priorities is to make sure that new projects and developments are pursued in the most innovative, eco-friendly, and heritage-conscious manner possible. La CCN adopte cette même approche pour la restauration et la rénovation des propriétés existantes. People sometimes see a conflict inherent between preserving heritage and achieving sustainability. In fact, this need not be an unresolvable contradiction. And in fact, it's at the core of what we do here at the NCC almost every day. We're responsible for hundreds of buildings in the capital, 1,700 properties altogether. More than 70 have been designated federal heritage buildings, including, of course, the 6 official residences. Bien d'autres sont d'importance historique pour la région, même si ce ne sont pas des édifices patrimoniaux reconnus à l'échelle nationale. You can see our commitment to this work in preserving such buildings and our capital's history in our program to mark the 150th anniversary of Confederation. I'll mention our Confederation Pavilions program, and some of you may have seen the passports that were handing out at the door. If you didn't get one, pick one up. Essentially, I asked our team to take our 10 least used but most significant properties, most of them heritage properties, and find partners to activate them in 2017 for the sesquicentennial with the hope of having a prolonged, sustained uses following the sesquicentennial. And we're very pleased so far that the 10 projects have come forward. 10 buildings have been reactivated, in some cases saved from destruction, in other cases brought back to life and beautifully so. Grâce à ce programme, nous vous présenterons 10 structures importantes de la région de la capitale. La CCN fait équipe avec des partenaires créatifs et entreprenants pour redonner vie à ces bâtiments dont plusieurs étaient en péril. Je peux mentionner le Fermour dans le côté Gatineau, aussi la maison Strutt dans le parc de la Gatineau. Ça, c'est 2 structures absolument extraordinaires et ouvertes au public pour la première fois. So these are the Moore Farm on the Quebec side, the Queen Anne riding structure that had been bequeathed to the NCC, that's now been brought back to life as an agricultural cooperative and has a wonderful bistro if anybody wants to go over. The Strutt House, James Strutt's house in Gatineau Park, with the Strutt Foundation, is being brought back to life and will be open to the public in the suburb. The old dairy building at the Rideau Hall is now the winter pavilion at the skating rink. 50 Sussex Drive, which is a more modern structure but has been unused, will become the new pavilion for the Royal Canadian Geographical Society. The Global Pluralism Center will open in the former War Museum. I don't know if any of you heard Shirley Bloomberg's talk last night, but you would have heard quite a bit about that. This is a very exciting adaptive reuse of the old War Museum. Another place to visit, and I did spend a very interesting day at Pickwocknagon with Sherry Lynn, the council members, and Chief Kirby White Duck. And one of the things we talked about was the possible uses of Victoria Island for a summer pavilion for Algonquin themed activities, and that's very exciting. And we have invested in the 150 Middle Street, that's the old Bronson Company headquarters, and it's been brought back beautifully, and the stone annex behind it with a lovely new roof and so forth. So I won't go through all of them, but pick up a passport, because it does touch on the subject we're here to speak about tonight. I'm going to go right through to introduce our guests to get the program going tonight. We're very, very pleased to have you three here. Thank you for coming. It's a great pleasure, and thank you all of you for coming out tonight. Jean Caroon is an award-winning architect, lead fellow, author, speaker, and advocate. She's a principal and head of preservation at the Boston-based architectural firm Goody Clancy, and she's the author of the book Sustainable Preservation, Greening Existing Buildings. Thank you, Jean, for coming. Mark Brandt, many of you will know, he is the principal of Mark Thompson Brandt Architect and Associates here in Ottawa and the lead author of Building Resilience, Practical Guidelines for the Sustainable Rehabilitation of Buildings in Canada. Of course, we've worked with Mark many times here at the NCC over the years. Thank you for coming, Mark. And Brenda Ogic is a cultural resource person at the Kitiganzibi Cultural Education Center, a former member of the Kitiganzibi Anishinaabeg Band Council, and a fellow with the United Nations Indigenous Fellowship Program. Brenda, thank you for coming, and we appreciate your presence. And thanks again for everyone joining us. We're looking forward to a great discussion, and afterwards, comments, questions from the floor, and enjoy the evening. Thank you.
So with that, I'll invite Jean to come up.
So I believe I'm being translated, correct? That's good. And thank you to all that invited me, to Mark for helping to set this up, and Susan Ross, and to Heather. It's a real pleasure to be here. Needless to say, it's a real pleasure to be in Canada, not in the United States right now. My husband has asked if I'm coming back. And I don't know how long can I stay before they evict me, you know? You have, but we won't go there, right? It's just been a gloomy time for some of us. But I wanted to thank you. I wanted to point out that although the title of this event is Heritage, a Driver of Sustainability, I have proposed that it actually be Sustainability, a Driver of Heritage, because I believe quite firmly that a sustainable world is a world based in health, and that we cannot be healthy without heritage. So that we must assume, rather than this conflict that we often discuss, the conflict between sustainability and heritage, or between sustainability and preservation, that there is no conflict. There is a misunderstanding, and that we need to work with all of us to change that misunderstanding. We cannot have a healthy world that does not recognize heritage. And I picked the picture in front of you quite intentionally. I'm sure many of you know that the most famous part of this picture usually crops out the building on the right-hand side. But to me, this is an image that embodies what a sustainable world should be and can be. It is an image of people interacting together, of people being in nature, of people having a surrounding environment all around them that speaks to the best of intentions of previous generations, which, as we all know, are often not the best and have left many scars and many marks, but they are still part of our heritage. So our jobs in understanding what memory is and what memory we need to sustain is always very challenging. But I would posit that we should be very careful about what we crop out, that a sustainable world also recognizes that what already exists has value. And when we crop it or demolish it or change it, we are not actually doing a kindness to the earth. And since I am in Canada, I can point out, and you will probably nod, that humans have definitely changed the planet. We are changing it every day. We know that. We don't know exactly how we're changing it. One of my favorite writers, or climate scientists from Cambridge, England, has written an interesting series of essays that are entitled Why We Disagree About Climate Change, which is not that we disagree that we've changed the Earth, but that we can't necessarily understand exactly where we're going or what the world is going to be. So all of us need to be somewhat flexible, somewhat nimble, and I think incredibly humble about where we're going and how we're going to try to redress some of the mistakes that have been so evident in the last 50 years. When one talks about sustainability in the United States, just as here, one often turns to the first to the conversation about energy, trying to redress the fact that we are dependent on types of energy that are pollutant, that cause considerable carbon. But as you'll hear, I believe that part of our challenge is that it is never just about one thing, and it is never simple. When we address just energy, we sometimes forget to talk about where clean energy is coming from, and that clean energy, too, often comes with a price for our planet, a price for our heritage, a price even for our souls, because of where it might be positioned. And that's part of the tough conversation that we all have to engage in. Unfortunately, there are no clean and easy answers in the stewardship of the planet or the stewardship of our heritage. And when we talk about energy, we too often forget the other pieces of it. Now, I do have to point out, sometimes I show this. I showed this slide once, and somebody came up to me afterwards and said, "So you don't like the house in the middle?" And I said, "No, I don't like the house in the middle. But I did. So I just want you all to know, I don't like the house in the middle." And the reason I don't like the house in the middle is it might very well be an energy-efficient house. It might be sold as an energy-efficient house. It might meet new energy codes, but it in all likelihood destroyed another house. It obviously is car dependent. Cars are a huge source of pollutants still. Transportation, the transportation footprint of houses is very extreme. And it's quite likely that fewer people live in this house than live in the houses next to it. So who cares if it's energy efficient? That is not enough. We cannot be single issue voters in this issue, in this conversation about sustainability and heritage. And the words that everything is connected ring so true to my heart. This is a picture of John Muir, who was one of the founders of the Sierra Club. And I love this because he was an environmentalist in the way we currently define environmentalists. He fought for nature, he fought for the protection of nature, and yet the stamp that commemorates him called him a preservationist. Preservation and the stewardship of our planet are intrinsically linked. And one of the things that John Muir said over and over again, that in many different versions of his journal and many different pieces of his writing, he said, "You cannot pull on any string, any piece of nature, and not find it connected to everything else." And that's what we have to remember as we pull on different strings. We cannot pull on energy and not think about the implications of where it's going. We cannot pull on new green design and not think about the implications of what it's had for the rest of the planet, or where the materials come from, or what we're doing to the other side of the planet. We have to take responsibility, and we have to recognize this partnership and this linkage that is always complicated, and by that, really quite wondrous, and something we should celebrate. Now, I mentioned this afternoon that in my lifetime, the world population has doubled. Actually, in a little less than my lifetime, the world population has doubled. And our trashing of the planet has exacerbated beyond the pale, so that in the last 50 years, we have used more raw resources and created more waste than all of the people before us. And that is really just untenable. And that is where the basis of my belief that we have to celebrate and think carefully about what already exists, because we cannot continue this pattern of consumption and waste. Every product has some kind of environmental impact. Every product. I mean, even if it's a mud house, it has some kind of environmental impact. And it's true that if we think about our own, each of us, our own environmental impact, you know, we might move very quickly to the Charlie and the chocolate factory where his grandparents are in the bed and they're just having gruel brought to them every day because you just want to pull the blankets over your head. But we can't pull the blankets over our head. We can't hide from what we are. And so much of what's on this planet is so marvelous and so beautiful and so in lifting up that is not the point to just focus on the dire data. The point is to really focus on what already exists, to celebrate it, and to change the way we live on the planet. We have The Sierra Club actually created the mantra of reduce, reuse, recycle back 30, 40 years ago. And we have embraced that by recycling and trying to move from the waste stream our very tiniest objects. But my practice, my life, is really trying to use our very biggest objects, which I believe are buildings. Over half the resources that are taken out of the earth and almost equally half the waste actually comes from the built environment, from construction, from making things, and then having them last not 100 or 200 or 300 years, but 20 years or 30 years or 40 years, and then we decide to do something else. That's really just not sustainable, and it doesn't have to change our way of life. You know, we don't have to think about sustainability as something that's punitive. I think, you know, in the old days we would have said sustainability is not about having warm beer. Sustainability is about having cold beer and hot showers. It's just doing it in a different way. It's not about deprivation. It's about sharing and using our resources differently and thinking about them differently. And for me, that means loving buildings, all buildings, even mundane buildings. And if this is somebody's mundane building, I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to be punitive about it or anything. But the point is that we tend in the heritage world to focus just upon heritage. But heritage is very diverse, and it isn't. It really has to look at everything around us. We have to expand our own thinking. And the great thing about saying that existing buildings are important is there's so many of them, and they're so diverse, and they're so interesting. And so, you know, let's celebrate that. Let's change the way we think. Let's change the way we talk. The heritage community, I believe, really needs to get off of our defensive mode, our protective mode, and trumpet the fact that this is really what a sustainable world is. A sustainable world is about taking care of what already exists. It's about changing our economic structure, because people don't move buildings because they love them. Well, okay, sometimes they do. But mostly they move buildings because they have economic value. So until we start to shift our economics so that every object, every building has economic value, where demolishing a building actually costs you more money than just the waste fees, we are really never going to stop this trend of production, build, waste, and throw away. Let's get an economic value on things that already exist, and then we don't have to be defensive about saving a window or saving a building or saving a place. So I'll just leave you with this. I would posit that most of you brushed your teeth today. You don't have to admit it if you didn't. But let's just say you did. If you brushed your teeth today, you not only understand stewardship, you celebrate stewardship, you practice stewardship. And that goes for almost everybody in the modern world, or that's the wrong way to put it. Most people that have any interaction with dentists brush their teeth, because they know if they don't brush their teeth, they won't have any teeth. So that's what stewardship is all about. And that's what taking care of our planet and our built environment is. If we don't steward our heritage, if we don't steward our planet, we won't have any planet and we won't have any heritage. So it's just as simple as celebrating what we have and remembering that it is an ongoing conversation. And for us within the heritage community, I particularly believe that we need to look at our own sort of parameters and define what heritage and stewardship really are. We need to be perhaps a little bit more flexible. We need to allow things perhaps not to be as pure in the interest of moving on and celebrating what is there. These are tough conversations. In the United States, a heritage building is not supposed to have visible solar panels. That really makes me crazy. I think that's not what stewardship is all about. I would just end by saying that sustainability is not just about the planet. Sustainability is about us. It's about us living on a planet. I promise you that if we destroy the planet is going to go on. We're just not going to be on it. You know, that's just the reality. So the planet will keep going. What we want is a planet that is good for all of us. We want a planet that celebrates health. And health is both about the physical world around us and it is about the spiritual world. So we need to come at it with the humility of children, with the celebration and joy of children, and think differently about how we're defining these things. Thank you.
I think you'll agree that was a wonderful and provocative start to our panel, so thank you very much. I'd like to turn it over to Mark. Okay, come on up.
Thanks, Heather, and yes, thank you, Jean, my good friend and colleague. Once again, you have completely inspired. My role tonight is much more practical and pedestrian, and when Jean and I exchanged presentations a few days ago, when I saw hers, I went, oh boy, you can really tell we're cut from the same cloth. I'll try to keep it to the new. I want to talk tonight about something that's near and dear also to my heart, and that's existing buildings. And I, too, have a strange title. Wake up and smell the existing buildings. The architectural community and planning community, construction community and real estate community, the heritage conservation community, and Jean called it the heritage community. She didn't call it the preservation community because she really knows how to talk to your model of the world. But all of these communities have not embraced the wonderful wide world of existing buildings. The heritage community has stuck dead center with traditional heritage buildings. The architecture community loves those sexy new buildings on the covers of magazines, et cetera, et cetera. So wake up, people, and smell the existing buildings. And one way that we are actually doing that here in Canada is we have a new guideline document that's a companion document, if you will, to the standards and guidelines. And it's a product of all of our senior governments, Parks Canada, all the provinces and territories. And when we were asked to write this document, I said, well, you know, there's already some sustainability aspects in the standards and guidelines. And they said, yeah, take it further. So that's what we're doing. And it's to harmonize the policy in a pan-Canadian fashion right across the country. So that's what they did. And it's based on a single piece of policy that all jurisdictions have agreed to, was the foundational piece of this this guideline document. Heritage conservation contributes to creating a sustainable built environment and resilient communities. So it's time that we in the heritage community, in the architecture community, all the communities stood for that, stand up for it. And that's partly what this document tries to do. Jean has already told us, buildings take up an enormous footprint of our energy, of our carbon, of all of our resources. Well, Jean's not the only one to tell us that. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the global authority on climate change, bar none, has told us, get your act together, people. Existing buildings is where it's at. If we can transform existing buildings, if we can make them sustainable, we have a huge jump on meeting our current climate change and carbon reduction targets. I won't tell you about all the wonders of heritage buildings and the socioeconomic and environmental benefits, but I will tell you a little bit about this book, because that's what I was asked to do tonight, and I hope you all have a chance to go. It's on historicplaces.ca under resources. And what you'll see there is the exact same document as this. This one has just been made prettier by doing it in InDesign. It's in four parts, and we really want people to use the document. It's not something to sit on a shelf, but actually use it. So anyone who may have a project to rehabilitate a building or is thinking about it, get it out. First section really sets the context and some of the things that Jean has been talking about, some of the things that I've talked about so far. In the second part, there's a real focus on making sure you understand the building. So it takes that tenet from the standards and guidelines and blows it way up. Because if you don't understand your existing building and you want to change it, chances are you're not going to change it very well. And understanding the building is not doing up a set of as-found drawings. That's just the first, like, 1%. You need to go in, you need to look at materials and assemblies, the planning logistics, design intents behind it, to really understand the building. So then you have the wisdom to make wise choices. Part two of the document also talks a lot about inherently sustainable elements, because in heritage buildings, traditional heritage buildings, they were designed with occupant comfort in mind, with no mechanical devices. So what's happened? Well, we've lost that. And many of the traditional buildings that you'll find when you go and understand them, you'll see that the architects, the master builders, they all understood the ways to do that. Find that. Find that in your existing building. That's an incredibly important part of understanding your building. Part two of the document also talks a lot of other issues. I won't list them all or explain them all tonight, but I'll just pick one, the unique challenge of modern heritage. It's an issue that we're turning to a lot. Our firm, for example, has three projects right now where we're dealing with sustainable changes to buildings of the modern era that have some form of heritage designation of some kind. And it's a real challenge because we don't go after them the same way that we do traditional buildings. It's a different mindset. It's a different conservation approach. It's different. Everything is different. It's a new paradigm, but the principles are the same to maintain the value of and preserve the value that which we value. The third part of the document is really the guts of the document. It is the guidelines to the document, and there you will find a very regimented, formalistic structure. Of how to work through, when you're working on a project, how to work through that. The format is basically mirrored to the standards and guidelines in order that it can work in harmony with that document. And it's broken down by building component just like the standards and guidelines. But you'll notice here the red fonted items are three new ones that are not in the standards and guidelines. They should be. And maybe the third edition of standards and guidelines will branch out a bit more, as they did when the second edition came out. So take a look at those three red ones. These are areas that'll play incredible, important parts in stewardship and sustainability. And then in part four, there's just a whole lot of other information that if you're doing a project, may not be apropos right away, but have interesting related facts and interest. And those of you who may not be doing a project might be interested in that. Now, there's even a rant by me about how we stopped designing for sustainability. But one of the key parts of the further information is the case studies. We were fortunate enough to find some existing Canadian case studies by the Vancouver Heritage Foundation, and they had done some amazing work on three or four case studies, I believe three of them that we took and got permission from them to reprint in this. And then we did a series of our own to add to that, where we reached out across the country to architects and design teams from across the country to. And we asked them to do the same format. So it's basically this format where you pick out what are the key sustainability strategies and techniques that you used to address the particular sustainability challenges of that existing building. And of course, what were the inherently sustainable elements? And so each case study is simply two pages like this. In this particular one, we Well, as the authors of the document, we got to put one of our own case studies in. And Sir John A. Macdonald Building is a few steps away here. I think one of the keys that we like to emphasize to people, because a lot of people in the design world don't really pay enough attention to, was on the building comfort systems. And notice I didn't say mechanical systems, but the building comfort systems. And in this particular case study, we took advantage, for instance, of stratification of air in the very large, tall hall. We took advantage of a number of things. Things like the red area at the bottom on the left, that's the only area you need to condition for the occupants. You don't need to condition that whole volume. So part of it is just common sense. Part of it is understanding the building. So in this case, you can see in the illustration on the right, the building used to have these long teller counters down the middle, and they had to be removed for the new use. But part of the teller counter function was to deliver air into the middle of the room. So what we did was create a series of what we called speaker benches, and we infilled about 12 different new interventions. The program for the building was sort of yay thick. There was a lot of new interventions required, very challenging. And what we did was we used those perimeter speaker benches, which kind of stay out of the way around the perimeter, for air delivery, for the manifolds, for the underfloor radiant system, for the different speakers, for music and speakers for speech, and a whole host of other things. Just a few what we call eye candy. I don't know if you agree, if you like the building or not. Some before and after. And I'd like to point out, Donald Macdonald is here tonight, and Donald was one of the champions of this project from the very start, and basically was our leader for the first part of the project, the project manager from Public Works. Incredible layers of craft and art. We were lucky enough to get our pictures on the cover of the Rolling Stone. This one here is, I think, kind of what it's all about from a design sense. Remember, it was a single design and conservation approach that we wanted to impart. And here's the new addition and the historic building sort of having a conversation across the atrium with each other. And there's a number of aspects that sort of inspired us from that. And in this case, we wanted to map all of the accumulated interventions and how they would impact, because we could focus on one set of interventions and make sure that they were an appropriate level of impact. But once you accumulate everything in a space, you need to know how that is. And the interesting thing is, when we did that, we really found a lot of these were the likely points for resilience opportunities. And I think that helped us a lot. So that's the main floor plan. Of course, you probably can't even read some of the finer print, but all the colored bits are new interventions in an earlier phase of the design. And then, thank God we had an attic story. Excuse me, because we were able to fit a lot of our contemporary interventions that were required in the program by the client using that space for that. And so here's a few of the environmental sustainability features. And while I'm at it, I think Nina DiGiovanni is here tonight too, and she was a key player in our partner architects, NOR, on this building. And so thank you for coming, Nina. And at the end of the day, in our real hard efforts over 8 years to preserve the heritage value of the building, we were able to achieve a 5 Green Globe rating. So we were pleased that there's a sustainability factor that walks the same path with the heritage preservation factor. And speaking of case studies, I just want to do 2 very quick ones. A lot of people have really, you know, ganged up and beat up on this old house, the Prime Minister's residence, 24 Sussex. And this one is from Maclean's magazine, just listing the litany of problems with it. And oh my gosh, it's just such a, you know, money pit for taxpayers. And another magazine, Ottawa magazine, went so far as to invite designers to come and do proposals for just demolishing this thing, take it off to the landfill and create pretty new buildings. And they were pretty new buildings, but that's not the point, is it? So in our office, we got a little bit ticked off about this. There was not one of the various opportunities in the magazine that talked about saving the building. So we set off on a little odyssey that we're almost finished, and we will finish once we try and find a few more minutes of free time. And we said, what you have to do, really, is the existing building, you know how, you know, in heritage conservation, you want to find an appropriate new use for an old building. Well, the use of this building has morphed into somewhat an inappropriate use, because it's not just a family residence. It's got to be an official residence in ways and have functions in ways that are not there to serve as a family residence as it was originally intended for. So we thought the best approach is to take a second building on the site, make it harmonious with this building, and then do a sustainable rehabilitation of this building. And that way you would hit the three P's, right? People, planet, and profit all together. So the economic, the sociocultural, and the environmental. So then the next thing that we did is we said, okay, well, what are our sustainability strategies in general? And so we came up with 24 sustainability strategies for 24 Sussex. And of course, what's the first sustainable strategy? Well, keep the existing building and reuse it, and reuse its energy and its embodied carbon and all of that. So, how you design a new intervention to sit beside or within a historic place is a hot topic, and there's a lot of different ways of doing it. Jean talked about expressions by people doing their best from each different age. I think you have to make an effort, and I think the opportunity is there because the existing building needs some pretty major rehabilitation. The opportunity is there to do what's the next layer on that building too, because it's been massively changed over the years, and make the two sort of sit happily together. But at the end of the day, the public doesn't really see this property, do they? I mean, there's your view from 24 Sussex on the top. That's pretty much what you see. So the new addition doesn't really change that. And there's your view from the Ottawa River on the bottom, and the new addition doesn't really change that. And speaking of the Ottawa River, last case study, I just want to run by you quickly. The story starts in 1990 when the NCC asked us to do... Oh, you know, before we go on, I do have a reverse button, don't I? I just want to say one thing. This proposal from us is completely unsolicited, has nothing to do with the National Capital Commission, is entirely just part of the public conversation about what are the options for our Prime Minister's residence. So looking at rethinking historic urban landscapes, this story starts when we were able to do the master plan. We were fortunate enough to be asked by the NCC to do the master plan for the islands area. And the story continues today, but I'll call it 2016, the Zibi project starts getting built. And, you know, the Zibi project has an amazing sort of progeny and an amazing set of targets from a sustainability point of view, including rehabilitation of some of the historic buildings. And, you know, one of 10 One Planet communities, it's pretty impressive. And I think, you know, there's a team on it that's going to do a good job. One can maybe question the density, and I think there's a lot of good things. Like Jean says, sometimes you have to pay for good things. So in the 1990 master plan, there was not one word about sustainability in the program. What we were after was really, really good quality urban design and some certain concepts like layering and mixing, public access and connectivity, was all about making it a great place, a place with deep meaning and a place of embodied memories. And in the cultural conservation aspects of the master plan, we came up with 29 different structures and sites within the district. And the district comprised, so the Zibi property is outlined in the dotted red line. The area that we were looking at was the green area plus everything in Zibi except that big chunk between the two bridges on the Quebec side, which is really the major piece of the Zibi property, in fact. But so what's left now on that where you see the green? A good almost half of the what we called the conservation heritage conservation resources in the site is still there, and that even goes without the conservation resources of the Indigenous First Nation communities. So there is a lot left, and I know that the NCC is very aware of that and walking down that path. So what we did in 2010 was, once we became very conversant with LEED for Neighborhood Development, is we said, I wonder how we would score if we did on this urban design problem for neighborhood development. And we scored it very conservatively because it's still just in the master plan, we just had a demonstration plan. And even conservatively, we got gold, LEED gold, and we said, what could we do if we were actually trying? We could go way beyond platinum. We could go to levels, where our Indigenous peoples would be about, you know, really deep understanding of the land. And in fact, that inspired me a little bit more when I had a chance a couple of weeks ago to go to Montreal and the Canadian Centre for Architecture. There's a really great exhibit there, very thought-provoking. Provocative exhibit that is an alternate history of Canadian environmentalism, and it really questions our image in Canada as being a very environmentally friendly neighborhood nation. One of the things that inspired me was reading this quote from Dr. Suzuki, and I think it's really true. We can do a lot of practical things now. We can do a good stewardship of our existing buildings. But at the end of the day, it's all one thing, isn't it? Environmentalism really can come from a deep attachment to place, and that's that intersection. So thank you very much. Here's some websites to get some more information. And one last point. You have on the front table some cards that will tell you a little bit more about the National Trust is joining with the Association for Preservation Technology this year to do the annual conference right here in Ottawa, celebrating Canada 150. And I'm pleased to announce for the first time publicly that we've just secured a joint plenary session, a special joint plenary session between the two groups that will deal with the subject that we're dealing with tonight. So it's going to be very exciting, and more information about that will come out over the next couple of months. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup, Marc. Et notez vos calendriers pour octobre cette année. Et vous pouvez prendre les brochures que Marc avait apportées. Je pense que Chris Weeb est ici aussi de la Fiducie. Je l'ai vu quelque part. OK. OK. So thanks very much. OK, thanks, Marc. And it's my pleasure to invite Brenda Ojek to come up. Our last speaker, thank you.
OK. Good evening, Dr. Christmason, Council Member Sherilyn Sarazen. Thank you for the nice words and words of welcome. Kwe kakana, bonsoir and good evening. Miigwechkabijaye gondije. I would like to thank Heather Thompson, Manager of the Heritage Program and the National Capital Commission, for this invitation to speak with you on the heritage and sustainability from an Indigenous perspective. Unlike Jean or Mark, I don't have any pictures to show. I don't have any slides or anything like that, but I'll try to, I'll try to inspire you with my presentation. I also want to thank Anita Tenasco, who is the Director of Education from the Kitigan-Zibi Education Council. She lives in Kitigan-Zibi and Anishinaabeg. And for her recommendation for me to encourage my participation here in this forum as a cultural resource person. and also to encourage the Anishinaabe cultural views and how they are applied in this modern day of constant change. My name is Brenda Ojig. Actually, it's pronounced Ojig. Through ceremonial practice, I was adopted into the Eagle Clan, and my Anishinaabe name given to me, it was Ogijida Ogimakwe, and which actually translates to warrior woman. I'm the daughter of a father who enriched my my sense of being throughout my lifetime by sharing his stories about his family, his grandfather, his great-grandfather. And so this has really enriched my values and throughout my upbringing. So it's really about this, the Ojik family line, and I'm really proud to be an Ojik. These stories anchored my schooling of cultural values necessary to adapt survival skills in a changing landscape world to the forum of a global community. There are stories attaching well-rooted disciplines of respect that demonstrate an ancient Anishinaabe history by simple rights remains the possession of the Anishinaabe nation's national interest. It is a legacy that is truly ours, and it is a responsibility to ensure its protection that will endure regardless of crisis, its unique level reality at all levels. It is a foregone conclusion that countless Indigenous histories continue to show that only Indigenous people can speak to the strength of what our heritage still possesses and what it offers. Although the remnants and the memories recorded about our original cultural heritage and principles of sustainability may be socially gestured as concepts of things of the past, they remain our inheritance for us to reconcile and give stability to an ancient purpose. It is our obligation to do so. Within the lodges of our social circles, where fundamental principles of ancient protocols are discussed, and where the words of our legends and ceremonial teachings are spoken to the efforts of people's awareness to act on sustainable issues in itself serves as testimony to the importance and the truth of ancestral visions. With this, I hope my presentation will be an attempt to voice with respect words and bundles in the scrolls of generations of our ancestral journeys, in which the language of yesteryears to the present day speak of their progressive social acceptance. This is an attempt to express the magnitude of challenges to rehabilitate a sense of balance that constitutes positive direction, to highlight the values of Indigenous sustainability that, in my view, will once again be a benefit contribution to the global quest for environmental, social, and political concerns. To begin, I would like to set a middle ground to express how language plays a vital part in understanding heritage and sustainability. By this, I mean that heritage and sustainability are colonial concepts to our people. Yes, today, we do use these words when referring to heritage as a place of belonging, whether we would speak to a specific issue or a general concept, because our society is compartmentalized. Yet we manage to maintain our interpretations by interpreting workable resolve to someone else's principle of heritage. There is no word in our language that would clearly define heritage or sustainability in comparison to how society looks at heritage in its forms of development or traditions immigration has brought to this land. To us as Anishinaabe people, our language is defined by describing what it is that is being addressed. As an example, we would refer to heritage simply as a way of life within the dynamics of whatever was happening within that era or that day. how we styled our way of living depended on environmental factors, the sustenance of foods, shelter, and being nomadic. We would not hesitate to move camps or villages. The main purpose for this was because we would not want to burden the region and the food sources that we lived in. Therefore, there was always an abundance of provisions, and the landscape allowed itself to replenish in a healthy way. Traditions and protocols that were developed were not fixed to one specific area as we moved. We took great measures to understand our movement within new landscapes from region to region. What may have been beneficial in one area would have been refined and improved as we temporarily settled within new areas. Family groupings and the relationship that bound kinship were educated and disciplined to respect values and principles of upbringing in taking care of the land, its resources, its food supplies, and the territory's natural boundaries. To us as people, we refer to this as a time within our history that we acted and lived as human beings. That being said, we may not have been civilized as a modern language would define the settlement and growth of people in a westernized concept, but we were highly organized socially and politically. We lived in Providence, always relying on what nature had offered, because unlike today, the knowledge our forefathers possessed was simple but very realistic to the protection of the living environment and to the people's usage of its resources. In our worldview, the Anishinaabe had complete understanding that it was not nature that would come to man for survival, but it was man that had to go to nature for his survival. Therefore, in our sense of respecting the environmental covenant dictating nature's rule, we had to act and function on a shared language between human and nature in the most common sense of intellect. Our teachings had a universal application in the upbringing of our children. As Anishinaabe people, sustainability was evolutionized throughout the generations by the sources of vision within the intervention of spiritual teachings. This enabled our survival for thousands of years, as shown by the footprints of our people's existence in our territories for countless eras. For a small and simple example, the way snowshoes would be framed and knitted to adapt to winter's own seasonal patterns. For the purpose of today's presentation, if we slingshot in today's concepts, embracing the evolution of a global community, and whatever good or bad these concepts bring to heritage and sustainability as a driving force, our worldview on heritage and sustainability as a driving force is also carried. Our ancient foundations of values that justify our ongoing methods in applying sustainability remains alive in our generation's profile and inherent possession. We are all in this together. Much could be said about the ancient structures of our nationhood in relation to sustainability and the protocols that were rigidly exercised to succeed in territorial sustainability. However, in the hourglass of historical events, from that ancient past to the present day, what is important and relevant to question is all humanity has come to a crossroad in addressing the concerns of what has developed to bring about a common global heritage. However, this is better left to another day. The matters of our immediate concerns to how heritage will be given a new purpose driven by sustainability is held with the highest priorities and concerns in our Anishinaabe worldview. No longer can we compromise the importance of sustainability for short-term goals that would compromise and further erode principles that have themselves sustained foreign concepts through the process of colonization. Pillars that continue to uphold the integrity of our mindset, our moral values that continue to induce vision, are still very relevant today on how we apply and manipulate with good intent a direction to positive and proactive sustainability. From the ancient times, when the Anishinaabe walked in freedom, to the bondage of becoming the institutionalized status Indian, the question remains, how does heritage of the past keep us going in a sustainable way, even though we live in present-day Indian reserves? Heritage to the Anishinaabe is all-inclusive, from sustenance of our belief system to the politics, to the social order or lack thereof. There is a resilience to forfeit basic values and principles as to who we are in our way of thinking. Heritage to us as Anishinaabe is inclusive to the land, its territorial borders, and places of special significance. Heritage to us as Anishinaabe is our relation to nature and how it has provided its natural resource for survival. Although our lives have now become compartmentalized in more ways than one, we do not prevent ourselves from asserting and speaking to our heritage. We assert ourselves to gather in our lodges and to explore the revival of ancient quests and teachings to push away the negative influence of religion that so damaged our moral foundations. Our lodges may not be structured in the ways of old, but the natural materials used in the days of old are still used today in our lodges that we repurpose to talk nation business. Heritage to us is upholding of what makes us complete, even though we have to walk and live in two worlds. The overall thinking and applying a positive mindset to not only rehabilitate, but to enhance the reality of our heritage is in themselves valiant efforts to disclose our willingness to, in the effort to promote the importance and right of privilege to the principles of sustainability. Finally, it is a rare but unique opportunity to engage with all of you about our history, our place, and what I envision a future for our children and grandchildren, a roadmap for a hope and peace where it's not too late for the original sustainable values will never fade away or forever be forgotten by the sands of time. Our existence is linked to sustainable values, and these values were woven to shape our existence, our livelihood, our coexistence with one another. But these values were never meant to be bent out of shape, to be redefined, nor were they meant to be lost in a world of promoting ideals of self-interest through the institutions and the masters who encouraged the theories of academia. Like my sister Sherilyn had mentioned about the history of our peoples, she had talked about Samuel de Champlain referring to us as Algonquin people, when in fact we are Anishinaabe, we are Ininiwug. And to us, that's a challenge for us because in our language is linked to the land, and that is where our sustainable is really at the heart and center in our connection to the land. So I have to say, Miigwech Kibizindawin, thank you for listening to my words. And I would leave you with this thought. The Anishinaabe has walked a very long journey, and the trials they have endured still remain silent in today's world. However, the Anishinaabe hold possession of the original prophecies of this land, which are still kept by our true faith keepers. In sharing a verse from these teachings, it is said that the world would come to a darkened period in its life, and should we want to see a life without suffering of our children, something would rise within the soils of the America. To me, we have a duty to come together and to reconcile the historical wrongs committed in this land. The Anishinaabe is part of the human family, and with the right leaders and true elders among us, I believe in a true vision of peaceful cooperation can be born and contributed to the survival of this country called Canada. And I, for one, will stand on guard for thee. Miigwech. Miigwech.
Miigwech. Thank you, Brenda. And thank you all, everyone. I think you'll all agree, if we could have one more round of applause for this very eloquent panel. I think they've really challenged us all to think about things very differently, to think about how we crop the picture, to try to root ourselves in place, and to really rethink the language that we're using around heritage, sustainability, and all of the work that we're doing all of us around this room. So, alors avec ça, on va ouvrir la section de commentaires, questions. On a deux micros ici dans les deux côtés ici. Alors, vous êtes bienvenus de venir, de demander des questions dans la langue de vos choix. Votre choix, et ensuite on peut traduire si nécessaire. Alors, est-ce qu'on a des questions? Do we have any questions to start off of any of our members of our panel? Oh, does anyone know questions yet? This is not a shy group. I know a lot of people in this room. Okay.
Thank you. I live in an area in Carlington that we consider important. It was the post-war suburbs that were created to get away from grid pattern of streets. They decided they were going to put in crescent streets to kind of slow down traffic. And I believe our community was one of the first suburbs like that built in Canada. Also, Westgate Shopping Center was also meant to service our area as well. And yet, when I've tried to talk to city planners or even city councilors, they don't seem to see any importance in that sort of heritage. I think that's a real important area that should be at least recognized somewhere. So.
I think it's an interesting question in the context of some of what you were talking about, Mark, about modern, well, actually both Jean and Mark speaking just about modern existing buildings and whether or not they have value and merit. Does anyone want to comment on that?
Well, I think it also speaks to what Brenda was talking about. Heritage is what you are. Heritage is what, where you come from and what you are. Where you come from, we all, Many of the people in this room grew up during the mid-century modern period. This is us, you know. Modern buildings are us. I think we've come to not appreciate a lot of them, but I think that's changing as well. I think the celebration of Briar Cliff and its designation as a Heritage Conservation District, which is a contemporary neighborhood, is a great example of the change in attitude about that. And that's what I was saying, like, heritage is us. It's what we want to be. You can't tell a community what their heritage is. The community will tell you what their heritage is.
Nancy?
Hi. My name is Nancy, and I'm with the Willibank School of Restoration Arts. I think we won the prize for maybe longest travel to get here, through a snowstorm, no less. I just wanted to say thank you to all the panelists tonight, because the whole topic of heritage and sustainability really strikes at the heart of what we're trying to do with our students at the school, and through an ecological approach, really understand the role that heritage has to play in the 21st century, and sustainability is a huge part of that. I guess a couple things. We're training, you know, the heritage professionals for the next generation, the 21st century, for jobs that don't exist yet, because I think a big part of sustainability is also thinking about new thinking, but then also new systems as well, and what those look like, I guess we're going to have to figure out, right? So I guess a couple things. Sort of on a personal level, I find it hard sometimes to remain positive with all the stuff going on in the world today. And I think Jean hit the nail on the head when the heritage movement has to maybe wean itself off of this defensive, hands-off kind of approach, and really embrace a positive way forward, and couch things in positive terms. So on a personal level, I'd love to know what you guys do to remain positive in the face of what could be some pretty negative stuff out there. Sorry to be a bit of a pessimist, but I'm looking for some tools here. The other thing I would challenge, in terms of heritage, we are coming up in the field now, this generation. We're seeing a wonderful heritage given to us from the 20th century, from the 19th century, which is maybe not so wonderful, you know, and maybe there are some buildings or value sets or stories that, you know, we shouldn't be carrying forward into the future. And I guess I'm curious about how you guys might feel about that in terms of what we carry forward in a positive way, what we don't carry forward in a positive way, how we stay positive. Any thoughts would be welcome.
I have thoughts. I just can't tell if I'm on.
Yeah.
Am
yep,
I on?
Yep, you're on.
Okay. Well, I do this. I come to talk to you, and I listen to Brenda, and I see that we all care, and that's what carries me on. And I think that each time we all gather in any way, shape, or form, there's a little nub that changes. For me, it was wonderful to hear, and I believe this strongly, that our language is reflective of what we're doing wrong, and that we need to break out of that. And I believe that actually the 21st century is going to be a time of great change. I think we've forced it on ourselves. And I think that change is often painful, and change is, at the same time, can be renewing and exciting. And so I think all of us need to challenge our communities, our places, our who we are in how we're thinking and talking. And I was thinking as I was listening to Brenda about when you think of language, I'm often notice that within conversations about sustainability or the planet, we are looking for solutions. That is like an end point. There is no end point in living on the planet. There is no solution that then makes it okay the way we live on the planet. You live on the planet in a continuum in the same way we live in our communities. And so I think as we approach the 21st century with a different attitude and humility, we really do need to hear ourselves and hear the way we're thinking and then listen to others. But I would just say there is a lot of dire data out there, but there are so many beautiful places in the world and so many wonderful gatherings, and that's really what we all have, and that's what keeps me going.
Thank you, Nancy. It's I really like the question. In our community, you know, we have discussions in our circles, and we always look at finding resolve to the many issues that we face in our community, whether it's sustainable or heritage issues, and you know, we're always on the defensive, trying to preserve or fight for something that we have lost, whether it's an artifact. You know, we develop a cultural center to preserve those things, you know, but what's important for us and for many friends and families that, you know, we do have our legends and our stories, and they really talk about they have stories that have open-ended questions, and they're not closed-ended questions where you're just going to sit there and you know, leave on a negative note or whatever. And I think in our community, we tend to get more into the storytelling of our way of trying to find resolve, to bring our people back together. You know, we come under the colonization rules of policies and regulations, and those are the things we follow. But you know, at the end of the day, we are Anishinaabe people, And, you know, we always say, you know, we're going to protect, we have to look forward and protect the seven generations, the next seven generations. And that's what we always do in whatever practice we do. I'm not sure if that helps in any sense, but these are some of the principles and, I guess, guidelines that we tend to follow. These are some of the guidelines we've always been told by our grandparents, you know, and our aunts and uncles, you know. You just can't go and do that, you know. Like, what about the next seven generations? What about your grandkids, you know? And that's the reality we face, you know. But, you know, at the end of the day, you know, we look at the world population, you know, the growing factors, you know, we live in a society of decay. And, you know, those are serious questions. And those are many questions I'm sure we're all asking ourselves. I'm not sure if that helps in any sense, but thank you.
That's great. Did you want to respond? Yeah.
I'll just say one quick thing about your other question, Nancy, about modern heritage. And do we really want to save all that stuff? Something that's positive that's being addressed is a new document coming out of APT that's called Renewing the Modern. And we're developing some principles for practice. It's just on circulation now. And I think it'll be somewhat an inspiring document that'll talk about, you know, dealing with I think everybody can agree that there's certain iconic modern buildings that are beautiful. And then after that, it's a big debate. And I think this deals with those sub-iconic, and this is a phrase that we're using, sub-iconic buildings. And I think people will be able to get some inspiration from that. So hopefully you'll get a copy and you tell me whether you're inspired by it or not.
I think we had a question, Brian.
Hello, I'm Brian Burns from Carleton University. There's a saying that I heard, a very short saying a long time ago that always stays with me, where somebody wondered what the future was for nostalgia. And I've heard wonderful comments tonight, thank you, which really are reflecting on failure, lack of recognition, things we forgot, things we didn't think about as we bounded forward into the 21st century. So I just wondered if you had any comments, being very positive and being a great optimist myself, on how we can plan for a goal in the future for our heritage, because heritage isn't past, it's also a heritage for the future. And we can all have good goals for what we can do on this planet if we think about it, but I wondered if you've got any notions of what our goals, real physical, practical goals, could be in the future so that my grandchildren, if I get them, not too soon, I hope, can have those principles of heritage that aren't founded on failure, on misinterpretation of forgetting, but are on where heritage is very much part of how we live. I just wonder if you had any thoughts.
Well, as I think that question, you know, that it is interesting, this word heritage, which is really just memory. And when we try to tell stories, we inadvertently, that changes the story. So the whole issue of stopping a space in order to tell a story is perhaps always going to be a failed exercise, because the story will always change, and the way that we see a place, the way we remember a place, the way we tell the story, the way our children and grandchildren see it will be different. But I think that that's actually quite wonderful, and I think as a preservation architect, you see, from the United States, I have to say that I'm a preservation architect. I preserve things. So when I preserve things, we are fixing them in a moment of time, but that's an impermanent fix. And I think the great delight of having stories that sometimes physical places or landscapes or other objects help us tell is that those stories will always change. And we, as people who care about the stories, will always need to readjust. So you know, for just an example, in the 19th century, a great deal of museum work was about restoring objects. A great deal of the work in the 20th century was about unrestoring those objects and the way they were done in the 19th century. And I feel that way sometimes about my stewardship of buildings, that I am often undoing the work that people did, that I respected, did 50 to 100 or more years ago. And so I just feel that I'm part of this whole story, and I'm quite confident that people will be undoing and redoing my work to tell the stories differently. But the stories will keep happening, and our re-envisioning of the stories will keep happening. And so it'll never be static. It'll just be interesting, and we will continue to argue discourse on whether this particular course we're taking on one place or another is really the right point in time for it. It's just fun, really, and challenging, and challenging sometimes.
It's funny, Heather. I had my answer to the question about recent inspiration I had in the desert. And then when Jean gave her answer, it reminded me of something else, so I'll start with that. There's a British architect named Edward Hollis, and he's written a book called The Secret Lives of Buildings. And please read this book. It's fantastic. And in it, one of his, he posits that buildings are like stories. And each time a story is retold, this is how Jean inspired me, it changes a little bit. And the reason it changes is it has a place in time, right? It has a new context, so the telling of the story changes. And then the next time it's told, it's within a new time and context. And it's the very fact that the story gets changed that keeps it going, from generation to generation. That slight change, whatever it is actually part of what keeps it interesting for the next generation or the next person to hear it. And buildings, he says, are the same. Buildings must change. Many architects think of their buildings as, you know, okay, that's it. That's the temple. You never change it. But in fact, he gives some great examples to support his theory that buildings must change or they will not survive. So heritage is about what that building becomes in our place and time. And we have to respect the past, and we have to think about the future. And my original desert inspiration story is I just came back from the desert, Taliesin West, outside of Phoenix, and I was at a conference, and there were people in the conference saying, really where stewardship is going is that when we complete a building, as a design team, when we complete a building, part of our deliverables will be the stewardship program at how to take this building forward in the future, and that you won't really complete your role as a design team until you do that. So that's a practical look at the future.
You just have to be ready in the seven generations of time to know that perhaps the third generation will disagree with what you have said, but you won't be here, so it won't matter. And we try to foresee the future, but that I think is part of our fallacy. But I like the idea that actually everything we're doing is thinking about the seven generations. I have spent 16 years working on H.H. Richardson's church, Trinity Church in Boston, and our team, this building is 140 years old, and our team honestly believes if Boston doesn't go underwater, and maybe it'll be dikes, so that won't happen, that Trinity Church, there's no reason it won't be here in 1,000 years. And so it becomes sort of Boston's York Minster, Boston Minster, I guess, or Boss Minster or something. And that means that we're sort of the medieval people. And so our job is really to try not to do too much harm so that 1,000 years from now, the seventh generation can look at this building and still get the same sense of joy and uplift or a different kind of joy and uplift that it gives to all of us. I think we need a little humility as architects, designers, and people of the world in what we think we can accomplish and what our role is.
Linda, did you have another comment?
I just wanted to comment that as an Indigenous person,
you know, we face many challenges. You know, we look towards 2017 when, you know, at the international level, they declared the world of indigenous languages. And here we are struggling to have our language survive in this day and age, the Algonquin Anishinaabe language. It's a dying nation, and we're all, our people are all in this trying to, you know, get this going because it, you know, we're all, it's all inherent within the land and within our people and within the ceremonies that we do. And you know, certainly, you know, it's a big challenge for us. And, you know, I do share those concerns, but from a, you know, from a different perspective. And I think that big challenge for me is, you know, looking at our languages, and because it's all interconnected. You know, we're talking about interconnection, and, you know, when we do set up our lodges, you know, we have our language, and we take down our lodges, and we put it to rest on the earth, you know, and that's who we are as Anishinaabe. And I'll continue to do that.
Brenda, did you notice that all three of us said, in our presentation, said some version of we are all connected? All three of us did. So I think that's got to be a big takeaway somehow.
I think we had a question.
Hi, I'm Vince Catelli with the Parliamentary Precinct. My question is around a curiosity, and that is the intersection of traditional knowledge and sustainability and heritage, and if there's any exploration research taking place around that, those intersections, the intersection and the potential of reinvigorating and or reinventing something around heritage, sustainability, and based on traditional knowledge. And maybe I might spur some research as a result of that question.
I think there's a lot of work that was done on traditional knowledge, you know, from the national level, from the different tribes to the international level. What I find peculiar is that at the international level, I don't think sustainability is even recognized in supporting the Declaration for Indigenous Peoples. It's kind of left out, I would, you know, I, from the last I've read. And this is inherent in our way of life, and as to the degree of what work has been done, I'm not sure what's out there. But you know, as Indigenous peoples, and in our ceremonies, we do have our protocols, and we kind of abide by them, and you know, that's pretty much. At a personal level, in most cases. I'm not sure if it's even gone out to what degree, or I'm not sure what you're referring to, if it's in public reports or studies. But, you know, I think it all depends on who you're dealing with at the end of the day.
When you were speaking in particular, I saw the other two nodding, and somehow They were taking away something, a new understanding, and I'm just wondering if there's a potential to open up. And then the quote of David Suzuki, mm-hmm. which is looking to the future, actually starts to spell that out as well. And so all of a sudden everything is starting to align in my thinking here of reinvigorating that conversation. And maybe looking to new generations and taking new generation interest in, mm-hmm. in First Nations into this as well. You know, you spoke about dying language or whatever, but this, I don't know, I'm just kind of speculating here, and I'm just curious of what the panel thinks about this exploration and so on.
Well, and Brenda, if I may, I know just before the session we were talking a little bit about some examples of this, where especially around conservation practice, where there is an intersection and sometimes a relearning within the conservation community of what conservation really means, especially when it relates to Indigenous heritage. So, for example, Parks Canada, when they've been working on Haida Gwaii, the poles out in the UNESCO World Heritage Site, the idea of trying to keep and preserve the poles intact, that was really challenged by the Haida people, saying, in fact, no, it is our heritage, but you know, we're okay with the idea that they can eventually return to the earth. And that whole idea of the dialogue between conservation professionals and also people who have that traditional knowledge and understanding of the values. And I think Brenda had a few other examples of some of that, where I think there's sometimes a relearning that needs to take place between, or a mutual learning, I guess, that can take place.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's a really interesting point. David.
David Jeans, Heritage Ottawa. Jean and Mark both talked about the energy embodied in existing buildings, and particularly Jean, when you showed us that three-story box that had replaced some building that when it was trucked off to landfill represented an energy loss, Mark was talking about the same kind of situation at the Chaudière. And I think the idea, Mark, that you were saying, where you can achieve gold or better LEED status for buildings like that, is partly with the sheer volume of the existing buildings there and the energy that they embody. And I know that the National Trust, Heritage Canada Foundation, pushed that idea of keeping existing buildings out of landfill as an energy conserving measure. But I wonder, has that argument actually gone beyond our small circle? Do the environmentalists actually understand and accept it?
Yes, but I would caution against talking about it as embodied energy. That was very, very common in the 1970s, and the National Trust in the United States actually used that a lot, and I still hear it a lot at preservation conferences, the idea of embodied energy. The point of reusing a building is that it avoids the environmental impact of the new construction. Whatever economic or environmental cost went into an object, it's done, it's there. The reason to reuse it is that it avoids the environmental impact of building something new. So energy is only one small piece of what it takes to make a product. We actually, if we really were going to care about what we environmentally spend on products, should be looking more at water and how we destroy watersheds and water environments and move water around the planet in terms of objects and food. But so rather than pin it as energy, and now we often see it pinned as carbon, which is sort of a shorthand version of trying to be more comprehensive, we really are just talking about the environmental impacts of new construction, of new materials. There is large spread movement and rules, laws happening to avoid landfill because of the recognition that landfill in itself is also extremely destructive. So, for instance, in Massachusetts, I forget, it's been at least a decade, I think, that you're no longer allowed to put large commercial building materials into landfill. So there's a wonderful organization out in Oakland, California, called Stop Waste Now, .org, and they, like others, their whole mission is just to point out that the reuse of buildings and the reuse of materials is really key. Oregon State has done, their Department of Environmental Protection has done a huge study about waste and construction waste, and lo and behold, recommended, after spending quite a bit of government money, that reusing buildings would reduce the construction waste going into landfill, and that building smaller buildings more effectively would also reduce construction waste, and that both of those things would reduce carbon impacts. So this is really just about thinking more holistically, but when we lock ourselves into one word, even I'm fonder of embodied carbon than I am of embodied energy, we really are talking about environmental impacts, and the environmental impacts are far more than carbon or energy. And they have impacts around far, far away from where we are, and we need to remember that. The environmental impacts touch everything. So yes, it is gaining a lot of momentum, and there's some of us that believe that one way to stop this or change this crazy dance is to stop the end point
to say, no, you can't do it that way anymore. You can't throw things away. Ironically, the poorest countries of the world have the best trash pickers because they don't throw things away. Things have value. But it is gaining momentum, and it is definitely changing the construction and architecture practice.
One of the ways it's gaining momentum is something that's coming on to, I think, will soon be mainstream, is demolition taxes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the Preservation Green Lab of the National Trust in the U.S. has a study, I'm sure many of you know, that found in very, I think, scientific terms, I think it's, you know, pretty a sure thing, to build a new green building, it takes 80 years for the effects that it has, that manufacturing or that building activity that Gene mentioned, before it's at that same level as the existing building it replaced.
Well, just to be fair, sometimes it's only 4 or 5 years. But, you know, the point, even if it were, you know, we just, everything touches the earth. Every product touches the earth. So we just, and not all products are able to return to the earth in a way that is good for the earth. So that's sort of the way the perhaps indigenous thinking or First Nation can re-educate us. But we also have to sometimes be ready to let go of things. And we have to not perhaps, there's always issues about what is saved and what isn't saved. And
I think we have time for one last question, and then we'll have to close.
But you really ignited me with the waste thing. It's a real pet peeve. Sorry.
No, that's great.
Hello, my name is Catherine Lindquist. I'm the executive director of the Council of Heritage Organizations in Ottawa. It's a long name. And I just wanted to thank you for the wonderful panel. The fact that you could bring together so many dimensions of heritage tonight, so built heritage, the environment, landscape, storytelling, cultural groups, was just fascinating. And that's our vision as well, is connecting Ottawans to our rich history and heritage. And I wanted to invite everyone to join us on Tuesday at Ottawa City Hall. It's Heritage Day. And the theme this year is My Canada, Mon Canada. And we will have a showcase of about 35 of our member exhibitors, and a number of them are here tonight. And some of us will be marking some very important milestones. So besides Canada's, for example, from the Bytown Museum, Robin Etherington, they'll be celebrating their 100th anniversary. We'll be celebrating our 25th. Heritage Ottawa, David and co. will be celebrating their 50th. The Peace Tower, its 90th, and so on. So it's a real milestone occasion this year. And we would like to connect everybody. Please do come out and visit us. It's about your lunch hour. So you'd come from 11:30. The ceremony's at noon with the mayor, Elder Shirley Kahoko. Chief Kirby White Duck will be there, myself. And there'll be a proclamation recognizing some of these milestones. So it's a chance to come and really connect and keep this dialogue going. Thank you so much.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Catherine. That's a great way to close our event. And so hopefully we'll see everyone next week. But in the meantime, we'd like to thank our speakers for this evening's presentations.
Thank you. Our next event, March 9th.
So when we